Good day, my name is Tian Gildenhuys, and in this video I would like to discuss the subject of culture, traditions and religion. Because many people do not understand how our cultures and our traditions affect our religion, or even vice versa. But we must compare it to what the Word of God says. Because if it's not according to the Word of God, my brother and sister, then it does not mean anything. But it is always still about our Lord Jesus Christ. So let us pray together. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you in this day. We thank you, Lord. The Bible says, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am in their midst. So, Lord, we know you're here. We'll be busy with this production. But you will also be there where people will be watching this video. And we pray that you alone will be glorified. We pray that the Holy Spirit will take me out of the way, that I will not be the one speaking, Lord, but that your Holy Spirit will speak in and through me. And thank you, Father, that you give us the authority to say to Satan, we bind your works now. You will not steal this message from the ears of the children of God in the name of Jesus Christ. You have bound people for long enough through their culture, through their traditions, and through their religion. And you will leave now in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus, now we pray that you will cover us with your blood, that you will set up your angels all around us wherever we were busy with this video. And Father, that you yourself will be a wall of fire round about us, that every place will be a safe place where we are busy with this video. Be glorified, Lord. We ask it in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, all who know me know I always start with this verse in 2 Corinthians 1 verse 13 that says, for we write none other things unto you than what ye read or acknowledge, and I trust ye shall acknowledge even to the end. And even today, we will see how important this verse is regarding our different cultures, traditions, and also religion and what the Bible says regarding that. Because in Matthew 22, verse 29, Jesus said, ye do err. In other words, you make mistakes. You are being deceived. Why? Not knowing the scriptures, nor the power of God. Because only when we get to know the scriptures, do we get to know the power of God. But why do we err? Because we do not know the scriptures. And why do we not know our scriptures, my brother and sister? Because we do not know the author of the scriptures, Jesus Christ. And I tell you, if you have not yet received the Lord Jesus in your life, at the end of this video, there will be a prayer that you can pray to receive the Lord Jesus in your life as well. Because it is all about having a relationship with Him, as we will see on this video. And if you start to know the scriptures, you will get to know the power of God in your personal life and in everything you do around you. It is an awesome adventure to be in a relationship with God Himself. Now let us start to see what different authors wrote about culture, traditions, or religion. And I give credit to every author whose work I use in my research on every video. So you can just see at the bottom of the slide who the different authors are that I used and or whose work I used in my research. This author says, culture is a word for the way of life of groups of people, meaning the way they do things. Different groups may have different cultures. A culture is passed on to the next generation by learning, whereas genetics are passed on by heredity. Culture is seen in people's writing, religion, look at that, music, clothes, cooking, and in what they do. Most broadly, culture includes all human phenomena which are not purely results of human genetics. The discipline which investigates cultures is called anthropology, though many other disciplines play a part. Now let's look at some characteristics of culture. Culture has five basic characteristics. All cultures share these basic features. Number one, culture is learned. It is not biological. We do not inherit it. Much of learning culture is unconscious. We learn culture from families, peers, institutions, and media. The process of learning culture is known as enculturation. While all humans have basic biological needs such as food, sleep, and sex, the way we fulfill those needs varies cross-culturally. So this is where the differences come in from different groups of people in different areas of the world. Their cultures differ because they learn it in the way they grow up among their own people. Number two, culture is shared Because we share culture with other members of our own group, we are able to act in socially appropriate ways as well as predict how others will act. Despite the shared nature of culture, that doesn't mean that culture is homogeneous, meaning the same. Because some people will say, but you know, it's your culture to drink tea with your pinky in the air, while other people will say, no, you don't drink tea with your pinky in the air. You drink your tea by slurping the tea, while other people say, no, it's disgusting. You don't slurp your tea. This is the differences in culture. Number three, culture is based on symbols. A symbol is something that stands for something else. Symbols vary cross-culturally and are arbitrary. They only have meaning when people in a culture agree on their use. Language, money, and art are all symbols. Language is the most important symbolic component of culture. Number four, culture is integrated. This is known as holism, or the various parts of a culture being interconnected. All aspects of a culture are related to one another, and to truly understand a culture, one must learn about all of its parts, not only a few. And then number five, culture is dynamic. This simply means that cultures interact and change. Why? Because people meet each other from across the world. They go to other places in the world. They meet other people of other cultures. And then they start to change their own ways because their culture is dynamic. All cultures are dynamic. Because most cultures are in contact with other cultures, they exchange ideas and symbols. All cultures change. Otherwise, they would have problems adapting to changing environments. And because cultures are integrated, if one component in the system changes, it is likely that the entire system must adjust. The culture of England, for example, is defined by the idiosyncratic cultural norms of England and the English people. Owing to England's influential position within the United Kingdom, it can sometimes be difficult to differentiate English culture from the culture of the United Kingdom as a whole. However, since Anglo-Saxon times, England has had its own unique culture apart from Welsh, Scottish, or Northern Irish culture, because they have different cultures. Humor, tradition, and good manners are characteristics commonly associated with being English. England has played a significant role in literature, science, social science, mathematics, drama, technology, democracy, music, and folklore. Many of the world's most important technological advancements and inventions were made in England by English people. English culture has had a profound impact across the world. And in the same way, my brother and sister, we've just now looked at what culture is all about and those five characteristics they have. And so you can also look at your own cultures. We have our own Afrikaner culture in South Africa. We have the Zulu culture or the Pedi culture. You have Hebrew culture, Jewish culture. You have German culture, Austrian culture, Australian culture. All these different cultures. And we all grew up in certain areas in the world and we all have our specific cultures. And language, art, money, religion is part of our different cultures. So the thing is, do we think that our culture is always right, even if it may be contradictory to the Word of God? And we will have to see what the Bible says about this. In Mark 7, verse 7 to 13, we read what Jesus says. He says, "Howbeit, in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men." So we grow up in our different cultures, and all the different cultures have specific religious ways of doing certain things, and we think our cultures are necessarily right. But Jesus says, "Howbeit, in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. For laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the tradition of men," as the washing of pots and cups is referring to a specific Jewish tradition in those days. and many other such like things ye do. And he said unto them, full well ye reject the commandment of God, that ye may keep your own tradition, making the word of God of none effect through your tradition. You see, because our different cultures all have our different traditions. So God says, Jesus is God, and Jesus says, full well ye reject the commandment of God, that ye may keep your own tradition. So thereby we are making the word of God of none effect through your tradition which ye have delivered. And then he says, and many such like things do ye. It's not just the washing of pots and pans that he was speaking about. Many different traditions throughout the world in our different cultures cause us as Christians to make the word of God and the commandments of God of none effect because of our traditions. And it is interesting to note in Mark 7, verse 7, he speaks about the commandments of men and he speaks about the commandment of God. And the word commandments of men in Greek is entalma. It means an injunction, that is religious precept commandment. It's used three times in the King James Version. Whereas the commandments of God in the Greek is entole. It means injunction. That is an authoritative prescription, commandment or precept. Can you see the difference? The commandments of men are religious precepts. And religion, my brother and sister, is not what gets you saved. Now, what is a religion according to the Collins Dictionary? Religion is belief in a god or gods and the activities that are connected with this belief, such as praying or worshipping in a building, such as a church or a temple. What is religion? This author writes, the word religion is one of those words that we tend to use all the time without pausing to consider its actual meaning. Most of us use the term to mean a particular set of beliefs. If you are Catholic or Protestant or Buddhist or Muslim or Hindu, then that is your religion. But a religion is more than a set of beliefs. I may believe that Elvis is still alive or that alien creatures built the pyramids, but that's not religion. The word religion comes from the Latin word religare, which means, look at this now, interestingly enough, to bind. It is related to the Latin word regula, which referred to a measuring stick and is the root of our English word rule. A religion, therefore, is not merely a set of beliefs, but a set of beliefs that bind the believer, and I've added to that, to a person. Because all religions believe in a god or gods, a person then or persons. Religion imposes a kind of rule or regulation upon the believer's life. In other words, religion is a belief that requires a response. In light of what we believe to be true, religious observers understand that we must behave a certain way, that there will be certain limits on our lifestyle. Question: what is the meaning of religion? Answer: religion is a fundamental set of beliefs and practices generally agreed upon by a group of people, usually then in a culture. They say, but this is what we believe in our culture, so this is also our religion. So it is generally agreed upon by a group of people. These set of beliefs concern the cause, nature, and purpose of the universe and involve devotional and ritual observances. They also often contain a moral code governing the conduct of human affairs. There are some 4,300 religions of the world. This is according to Adherence, an independent, non-religiously affiliated organization that monitors the number and size of the world's religions. Sidestepping the issue of what constitutes a religion, Adherence divides religions into churches, denominations, congregations, religious bodies, faith groups, tribes, cultures, and movements. All are of varying size and influence. Now, Blaise Pascal, he was a French mathematician, philosopher, and physicist that lived between 1623 and 1662, said the following, very interesting. There is a God-shaped vacuum in the heart of every man, which cannot be filled by any created thing, but only by God the Creator, made known through Jesus. Christianity is more than a religion. It is a relationship with Jesus Christ. And there is the whole point. My brother and sister, your culture cannot save you. Your traditions cannot save you. Your religion cannot save you. It's all about being in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And Blaise Pascal said it very well. There is a God-shaped vacuum in us. And that God-shaped vacuum can only be filled by God. The moment that we enter into a personal relationship with Him, we try to fill that vacuum with alcohol, with drugs, with women, with wine, with money, with whatever the case may be. You cannot fill that vacuum. The only way to fill that vacuum is to allow God to come and fill the God-shaped vacuum that He put within us. And then we start to enter into a personal relationship with Jesus. Because I tell you today, religion is dead. Traditions are dead. Only a personal relationship with Jesus Christ is life and brings eternal life. And again, if you have not yet received the Lord Jesus in your life, at the end of this video will be that prayer. Please pray that prayer from the depth of your heart and receive Him in your heart. And if you wonder why we should do these things, I also have a YouTube video on how do I give my life to Jesus Christ and why we should do this, because the coming of our Lord Jesus is very close at hand. This author writes, John 15 verse 9 says, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now continue in my love." John 15 verse 15, "I have called you friends." John 17 verse 24, "Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am." John 15 verse 13, "Greater love has no one than this, that he laid down his life for his friends." Jesus summarized the true meaning of religion in Matthew 22 verse 37 to 40. "Love the Lord your God." That is personal relationship. You cannot love God through dead religion. You cannot love God through dead rituals. You can only love a person if you are in a personal, intimate relationship with Him. So love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Christianity has always stressed a personal relationship with God as the touchstone of religion. When God created Adam and Eve, He enjoyed their fellowship. This is what it was all about. God created man so that He could have fellowship with them. Remember, He had the angels, millions of them around Him, but still He wanted fellowship with the being that He created to love Him back, because He loved them first. Religion was and still is supposed to be a close, personal, and satisfying relationship with the Creator God. And therefore we read in Galatians 1 verse 13 and 14, where Paul now describes the religion that he came from in comparison with his new relationship that he entered into. He says, "For ye have heard of my conversation," that word conversation also means behavior in the Greek, "in time past, in the Jews' religion, how that beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it." Now look at this. So he was a Jew. So he had the Jewish religion. He grew up in the Jewish culture and he had that religion. But his religion did not bring him closer to God. His religion made him persecute the church of God. "So how that I beyond measure I persecuted the church of God and wasted it, and profited in the Jews' religion above many my equals in mine own nation, being more exceedingly zealous of the traditions of my fathers." You can't have it put more clearly that his Jewish religion coming from the traditions of his fathers did not bring him closer to God. No, it actually had him persecute the people of God. So how many of us also grew up in dead religion, in specific religions, and we thought we were doing the right thing while we were actually persecuting people who really loved God, because we did not understand that they were in a personal relationship with Jesus, while we were busy with our culture's specific traditions and our specific religion. And our religion was dead, but they had a relationship, yet we persecuted them instead of understanding we were the ones that were being bound by our religion. 2 Thessalonians 2 verse 15, Paul says, "Therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or our epistle." Now, this we must understand. So there are traditions that are in line with the Word of God, the traditions that were taught to us by the apostles according to the Word of God, and we must hold to those traditions. Those traditions will be the ones pulling us closer to God, pulling us closer into an intimate personal relationship. We read in all these epistles written by Paul, by Peter, by John, and in the four Gospels, and in the book of Acts, and all the books of the New Testament, we read what new traditions we must follow so that we can get closer to God in our own personal intimate relationship. And we also see this in Colossians 2, verse 7 and 8, where he says, "As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving." You see, these are the new kinds of traditions we are being taught, that we receive the Lord Jesus, so we must walk in the Lord Jesus, we must be rooted and built up in him, established in the faith of our Lord Jesus. Why? Because we love him and we are in a relationship with him. We want to be obedient to him, not to our church anymore, and the church rules and what the church says, and if we don't do what the church says, we are just kicked out of the church. No, that's not relationship. God's relationship is that we walk according to what the Word teaches us. And then look at the blue part. Beware, lest any man spoil you. Spoil you how? Through philosophy. Oh, all these philosophies. People so love to study philosophy and all the different philosophies of the world and all that. The Bible says beware. Beware, lest it spoils you. Lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. Look at this now. After the tradition of men, because those philosophies were written by men. They are the commandments of men. Oh, this man, he saw this, and this guy, oh, you know, he studied this philosophy, and then he was taught that philosophy, but it's contradictory to the Word of God. So beware, my brother and sister. You must be rooted and established and built up in Christ, not in philosophies that are commandments of men. So beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. These things are from the world. They are written by men. So don't be spoiled. Don't be pulled away from the truth of the Word of God through the philosophies and the traditions of men. 2 Thessalonians 3 verse 6 says, "Now we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye withdraw yourselves from every brother that walketh disorderly, and not after the tradition which he received of us." So what the tradition did the brothers receive from the apostles? The traditions that had people get closer to Jesus, that pulled them closer into a personal, intimate relationship with Jesus. And if a person really, really is in a personal, intimate relationship with the Creator God, with Jesus Christ, he cannot walk disorderly anymore. You cannot be like the world anymore. So if a person does not walk according to the Word of God, and which was taught by the apostles, pulling people closer to Jesus, then you know he is not following after the traditions of the apostles, which will teach people to get closer to Jesus, which will not pull them away from Jesus, like the old traditions that we grew up with, that had people even persecute other believers, persecute the church of God. Those are traditions that make the Word of God of none effect in people's lives. In 1 Peter 1 verse 18 and 19, Peter says, "For as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation, your vain behavior, received by tradition from your fathers. You see, the tradition from our fathers causes vain behavior in our lives. We think we are so holy because I am in this tradition of wearing a specific kind of clothes. You know, this is my culture and my tradition. If I wear this clothes, this piece of clothes, or this specific tie, or this specific suit, then I'm holier than the rest of the people. But the Bible says, you were not redeemed with corruptible things. You are not saved by the clothes that you wear when you go to church. You are not saved with any physical things. The clothes you wear, or the car you drive, or what group you belong to, or what leader you follow here on earth. You are not saved by that. You see, but you were saved from your vain behavior received by tradition from your fathers. How? Look at the blue part now. But with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. This is how we were saved, through the blood of Jesus. And the moment that I receive that by faith, what he has done for me at the cross of Calvary, when I know I'm saved by his grace, what happens then? I start to follow after him. I live in a personal, intimate relationship with him. Then I don't care to wear a white tie or a black suit, or to look very prim and proper when I sit in church. That does not save you, my brother. Not the clothes you wear, not the group you belong to, that does not save you. Not the culture that you belong to, that does not save you. My brother or sister, please do not place the traditions of your fathers or forefathers before the Word of God any longer. Your culture, traditions, and religion cannot save you. You are putting your eternity in danger if you want to keep on believing the culture, tradition, or religion of your fathers or forefathers. What modern traditions do we have today? Things like Christmas with all its trinkets. I have a whole YouTube video on the Christmas lie that you can watch if you want to see where it really came from. It has nothing to do with our Lord Jesus Christ. Easter, Valentine's Day, Mother's Day, Father's Day, Halloween, the so-called heart symbol, praying hands, the cross symbol, Jewish traditions according to extra-biblical rabbinical sources, Roman Catholic traditions, for example, the Mass, the Rosary beads, purgatory, indulgences, etc. I also have videos on all this, on Roman Catholicism versus the Bible, on Jew and Gentile worshipping together, on the praying hands, on the cross symbol. There is a lot of information available regarding all these things, either on all my YouTube videos that I have, or throughout the internet. You can just watch it with the discernment of the Holy Spirit and you will see the truth of these things. These are all traditions that have bound thousands of Christians over the years. Traditions regarding speaking to the ancestors and the ancestors speaking to God. I also have a YouTube video on Can We or May We Speak to the Dead, where I discuss this. Traditions regarding salvation through infant baptism. People believe we are saved when we are baptized as babies. That is a lie. I also have a YouTube video on the believers' baptism versus infant baptism. You see, these are traditions that came from our cultures and from our churches, and they cannot save you. And then I wrote there, and many other such like things you do. There are so many traditions out there, but we must understand today, we must get out of our specific cultures, out of our traditions, and out of our dead religions, into a personal, intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. And then we understand one thing. Then we start to live in a new culture, our Jesus culture, our godly culture, in a personal relationship with God himself. And we walk according to his word. Because we have trusted in people for long enough. And we read in Jeremiah 17, verse 5 to 8, thus saith the Lord. The Lord, again, in capital letters like that, L-O-R-D in the Hebrew, is Yod, He, Vav, He. So our Father's name in Hebrew, Yahweh. Thus saith Yahweh, cursed be the man that trusteth in man, and maketh flesh his arm, and whose heart departeth from the Lord. You see, my brother and sister, if you put your trust in your pastor, in your reverend, in your minister, in your priest to teach you these things, and you do not make the effort to study the word of God for yourself, this verse says, you are cursed. Cursed be the man that trusteth in man, and maketh flesh his arm, and whose heart departeth from the Lord. And how will that man be? For he shall be like the heath in the desert, and shall not see when good cometh, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land, and not inhabit it. Blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, that trusteth in Yahweh, and whose hope the Lord is. How will this man be? For he shall be as a tree planted by the waters, and that spreadeth out her roots by the river, and shall not see when heat cometh, but her leaf shall be green, and shall not be careful in the year of drought, neither shall cease from yielding fruit. This is the difference. If you put your trust in a man to listen to the opinions of people, and you do not test what they say to the word of God for yourself, you're bringing a curse upon your own life. God says, cursed is the man that trusts in man. So you must trust in God. Because if you start to trust in God, His Holy Spirit will reveal the truth of the word of God to you. And then you stop your cultural traditions and your cultural religions, and you get into a personal, intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. You walk into the Jesus culture. You walk into the kingdom of God. You become part of a new family. I discuss it in detail on my YouTube video of Jew and Gentile worshiping together. So go and look what the Bible says about the church of God, about the ecclesia, about the called out ones. Because we so trusted in the wise men of the world, yet the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 1 verse 19 to 21, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom, in other words, worldly wisdom, knew not God, it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. So many people say to me, but Tien, you know what? I have 7 different degrees. I'm a wise man. I've got knowledge about the atoms and about science and about this and that. And then I ask him, but do you have knowledge about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? You see, because the wisdom of the wise, the worldly wisdom, will profit you nothing when you die and you stand before the throne of God one day. And that is why the Bible says God chose by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. So the moment that I believe what the Bible says, not standing on my worldly wisdom and my worldly knowledge, only when I receive by faith the things that God did and said in His word, and also waiting for eternity, knowing that we will be with Him in all eternity, only when we believe, we will understand what the word of God says. Because the wisdom of the world is foolishness with God, the Bible says. You can have 25,000 different degrees, my brother and sister. If you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ personally, eternity is waiting. And I also have a video on hell is also real and hell is eternal. I believe it because the Bible says it. So my brother and sister, you will have to choose after listening to this video today. Are you still going to stand on your culture, on your traditions, or on your religion? And do you know that you are going to die one day? If Jesus does not come sooner to take us to be with Him, we are all going to die one day. Are you ready to stand before the throne of God while you trusted in a man who came from a specific culture or a specific tradition and who taught you certain traditions? Are you going to trust in Him? Are you willing to put eternity on the line? Are you willing to put eternal life or eternal death, eternal life in heaven or eternal death, eternal hell on the line because you trust in your culture or you trust in your tradition or you trust in your religion? Because none of those things can save you. Only a personal relationship with Jesus Christ can save you. What do you choose? Because we must remember, he is not a dead God. Jesus said in Revelation 1, verse 17 and 18, "Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen." And all honor and glory goes to Jesus Christ of Nazareth. So let us pray together. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we thank you, Lord, that you in your goodness decided that we will be saved by the foolishness of preaching if we believe what is preached to us according to the word of God. Not the traditions of men, Lord. Not the cultures of men, Lord. Not the religions of men, the commandments of men, but the commandments of God. And Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit will prick the hearts of the people watching this video. And if they have still been caught in their cultures, their traditions, and their religions, that they will today make a decision to receive the Lord Jesus Christ in their lives and to start to walk a life of faith, a walk of faith in all eternity, that they will be rooted and established and built up in Christ, and that they will enjoy their relationship with the Creator God. And Lord Jesus, we know your coming is at hand, and we keep on crying out, Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. Amen.